Hello, good morning, everyone. Welcome to GS215. My name is Vincent Wong, and I'll be your teacher for the semester. It is the first class, so we will just wait perhaps a couple more minutes while people are still coming in, and then we will officially begin. So please just sit tight. Okay, I think we will get started. So welcome once again, everybody. And I'm Vincent. I see a lot of familiar names that you had me as your teacher last semester. So welcome back. And for those of you who have in my class for the first time, welcome. So before we begin the lecture today, I just want to go through some of the basic things about eCentennial and where you can find information for the course, as well as go through some of the expectations of the course, the type of evaluations that we will do, for example, and how the labs are going to be done. If at any time you have any question, please feel free to just unmute and ask the questions, or you can type it in the chat box. And I will address them accordingly. The session is being recorded and will be made available on eCentennial after class. So, if you have to leave during the session because of other because of you have other things to do, then you can check the recordings later on to see what you have missed. And so this is the course homepage, and I will be posting news items at the beginning of the week, as well as towards the end of the week. Okay, so at the beginning of the week, I will kind of give you a heads up of what is coming up this week, you know, what lecture you should be downloading, if there is any quiz or tests that are due this week. So all the information will be posted there. And kind of at the end of the week, I will have a debrief to tell you, you know, notes has been posted, recordings have been posted, and also remind you of any upcoming assessment. So please do check your eCentennial page regularly. Email is the primary way of communication since this is an online course. I do check my email quite often. And if you email me during like regular school hours, I probably will get back to you almost immediately. But if you email me at odd hours, like at night, then maybe you have to wait until the next morning. But I always reply your email no longer than one day. Okay, so if you send me an email and you don't hear back from me for more than 24 hours, that means I did not get your email. Sometimes maybe it didn't go through, maybe you sent it to the wrong person. So just resend the email. Now, very important is because I do have several classes, they're not all anatomy, physiology. So when you email me, you have to tell me what class you're from and what section you're from. Okay, so you are from GS215 section 201, right? Because sometimes students send me an email and say, what's the quiz going to be on? Then without knowing what class you're from, it's hard for me to answer the email quickly, right? And then I would have to ask you, and then that delays the process. So just make sure you tell me what class you're from, and I will be able to give you the information, quickly. As I told you in the email I sent you at the beginning of the year, everything will be done through Zoom, and it's going to be the same Zoom link every week. So you can just bookmark it and log on every Monday and Wednesday. Both classes will be synchronous, but recordings will be available afterwards, as I've said. You don't need to buy any textbook. We'll just be using the open source textbook, and you can click on the link here to get it. The textbook is supplementary, which means if there are additional information that are in the textbook that I did not cover in class, you will not be tested on them. All the test questions will be based on the PowerPoint slides, the study guides, as well as what's being said in class. So what you want to do is you want to download the weekly schedule if you haven't already done that. So you can just click on this bubble. And it will take you to this weekly schedule, right? So today we're doing the cardiovascular system. Most of the lectures are pretty long. If you have downloaded the PowerPoint slides, you will notice they are you know, 70 slides, 90 slides long. So we won't be able to finish everything in one session. So usually it would take two classes, right? So we'll go through the PowerPoint and then we'll do some study guides. The two things kind of go on simultaneously in parallel. So when you come to class, it is important to have the PowerPoint slides as well as the study guides, okay? I don't want this to be a passive experience. You should be taking notes as you would in an in-person class, okay? And we'll be actively using the study guides as part of our lecture as well. So make sure you either have a digital copy or print it out. I think printing it out would be more appropriate because there's a lot of diagrams that we're going to be labeling in the course. It's pretty hard to label it on a computer, you know, with a mouse or whatnot, right? If you have a tablet, excellent. But if you don't, it's much better for you to print the notes out and print the study guides out so you can follow along as we do some coloring. We do try to do one lecture per week, and then we will have some review closer to the test. So in terms of the assessment aspect of the course, what we will have is something like this, okay? So we're going to have three units in the course, okay? Three units. So first unit, unit one, we are going to have four lectures. So lecture one to lecture four. And within the first unit, you will have a quiz. Okay, so the quiz is going to be 10% and it's only going to be on lecture one. And then later on in the semester, you would have test number one, which will be 20% and it will cover lecture two to lecture four. Right? So whatever I test you on quiz one, you're not responsible for it anymore on the first test. There will also be a lab, which is 2.5%. And that covers lecture one to lecture four. All right, so that's going to be your unit one. So in a sense, it is not too bad because things are not cumulative. You get quizzed on it, then you can sort of, you know, not study again for the test. And then unit two, right, is going to be another four lectures, and it follows the same format. Okay? You're gonna have a quiz again, which is 10%. And this time it's going to be lecture five. You will have a test, which will be 20%. And then it's going to be lecture six to lecture eight. And once again, you will have a lab, 2.5% for the entire unit two. Okay, I'll get to the lab in a second. Someone just messaged me and asked me about the lab, so just hang on there. So yeah, so that's the second unit. And then the same thing for the third unit, right? I'm not going to write it out. The only difference for the third unit is that the lab will be worth 5% instead of 2.5% because there are just like more material to cover. And that's why it's going to be worth more marks. So three quizzes works out to be 10% times three, which is 30%. And then you have the three tests, which is 20% times three, that gives you 60%. And then you have the lab, which is 2.5 plus 2.5, and then plus the 5%, that gives you the 10%. So that's quiz, test, and lab, and that's the 100% of the course. So anybody have any question about the evaluation aspect? I'll go through, you know, what to expect on the quiz and tests in a bit, but in terms of the breakdown, are there any questions? All right, so that is that. Of course, you can find all this information in your course outline. If you go back to the homepage here, there's a button for the course outline. You can click on that, and everything I've told you about the breakdown is going to be in this document, like right here. Okay, and so another thing is if you do look at the course outline. They do have a weekly schedule as well, but you know, don't look at the dates here because they might not match completely with the weekly outline. This is just for like template purposes, what we do follow is the weekly outline that I showed you. So the first quiz is going to be happening on the Wednesday of January 25th. Okay. And in terms of, you know, the quizzes and the test, I just want to explain clearly that it will be available from 6 a.m. of the day all the way to 11:59 p.m. Okay. So you would have the whole day to gain access to the quiz. But you know, once you start the quiz, you cannot exit the browser and then come back to do it later, right? As soon as you start the quiz, during that window between 6 to, you know, basically midnight, you will have to complete it. Okay, so quizzes usually are about 40 minutes or so, and tests is usually about 70 minutes. But of course, all these information I will post on eCentennial as we get closer to the evaluation dates. There will be no lockdown browser, and you are free to use your notes, okay? In fact, sometimes during lecture, I'll say, you know, make sure you put this on like your we call it like a help sheet, cheat sheet, whatever you want, right? Reference sheet, okay? These are information that are useful, perhaps during the quiz, during the test, that will help you answer some of the questions, okay? So another thing that you should know is the type of questions that are going to be on the quiz and test. So there will be the standard multiple choice questions that are like factual. So things that you have to memorize, things that you have to know as part of your knowledge type of question. You still have to study for them, okay? So like, I don't want you to get the misconception that because you have access to your notes, then I don't have to study. I can just look them up. Sure, you can look them up. You can look up the information, but that's going to take time, right? Okay. And you know, you don't want to be spending too much time flipping through your notes. That's why it's okay to have a reference sheet, right? With, you know, just very, sometimes it's hard to memorize everything. I understand that. So, you know, if you have a reference sheet that have just key information that you find particularly difficult to remember, that's fine, right? You can look at your cheat sheet, look at your help sheet, whatever you want to call it, okay? But flipping through all your notes, scrolling through your PowerPoint slide to find the answer on the test on the spot, that probably is not a good idea. So you still have to study for it, okay? So that's the standard multiple choice questions. You will also have application questions. So these questions are not something that you can just flip through your notes or Google or whatever. It really requires you to think about what you have learned and apply it in a new situation. So some of these questions, they would seem like it's something that I haven't taught you, okay? But actually, you have to use information that I've taught you to apply to that scenario in order to answer the questions, okay? And we will be doing some practice application questions through our lecture as well. So rest assured, I will prepare you well for the assessment. And finally, the third type of questions would be multi-select question. I don't know if you have had that before in other online courses, but these are questions that would have multiple correct answers, okay? And in order to get full marks, you will have to select all the correct answers, okay? So that's the evaluation piece. Does anybody have any question about anything I've just said?
I have a question.
Yes, please, Leah, go ahead.
Yeah, so for your application problems, would that be a short answer or would that
multiple choice? Everything is multiple choice, even the application questions.
Oh, okay. All right. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. Anyone else? All right. Well, if you think of anything else later, please feel free to just leave your question in the chat box and I'll be sure to address them. And then the lab quiz. Okay. Lab quiz. Like I said, there's 2.5% for unit one and two and 5% for the unit three. And the purpose of the lab quiz is there are two purposes to it. Okay, number one, it serves as a review tool for your unit tests. Okay, as you can see, the lab quiz is always due right before the test. Okay, so another lab quiz before the test, lab quiz before the test. And number two, the purpose of the lab is to help boost your marks a little bit. Okay, it serves as a little bit of a buffer to help you do better in the course. So what do I mean by that? Well, let's take a look at the labs. Okay. Oh, by the way, everything in the course is already fully uploaded in the eCentennial. Okay, so like if you want to go ahead and you know just read ahead in the course, you're very welcome to do that. So if you go to table of contents, you see unit 1, unit 2, unit 3, right? Okay, and all the lectures are posted with the worksheets and all that stuff. But what you want to do is you want to go to the lab, okay? And there are 3 labs here online, lab 1, 2, 3, okay? And you just click on lab 1, for example. Okay, please pay attention to what I say about the lab, because I don't want you to do extra work that you don't have to, okay? So what you need to do, excuse me, is you have to download this PowerPoint, and you are going to go through the slide yourself, right? So for example, label A, B, C, D, and state their function, right? So this is kind of like a worksheet package that you go through. If this was like in-person class, like face-to-face, you would be in the lab physically holding this particular model. These are models that we actually have, right? So I just took pictures of them. And you know, in the classroom, you'll be holding the model and then answering the questions in the classroom. But now you're just doing it virtually, right? You have the picture here. You just write down what A is. Does anybody know what A is by any chance? I mean, we're going to learn it today, but you know, just want to throw it out there, see if anybody know what A is called.
The aorta.
Yeah, thank you. That is correct, right? So you would write this down as aorta, right? And you would state the function, whatever that happens to be. Okay, you can do it, you know, on a physical piece of paper. You can do it directly in the PowerPoint if you want to download it onto your computer. And then you just go through the whole thing. Okay, you just go through the entire package. Okay, and you do not have to hand this in to me. Okay, this is only for your self record, and you keep it. Okay, then when you're ready, when you have finished this online lab, right, what you will do then is to go to assessment quiz, and again, right, like closer to the due date, I will post links on eCentennial, so you will be able to gain access to these things. Okay, so you will go and do your lab quiz. Right, so I'll show you what the lab quiz looks like. Start the quiz. So there will be some standard multiple choice like these, okay? But then there will be, let me just see, because it's a randomly generated, so I don't know what the question I'm looking for is going to be located at. Give me 1 second, it should show up soon, hopefully. Oh, there we go, okay. So you might get some questions like these, okay? Like the model right here. And then it's asking you, oh, what is this thing, right? So if you had done your lab, right, the PowerPoint slides, you would have seen this model and you would be able to know what the answer is. I mean, like you probably would know it too if you don't do the lab and just study your notes, but it's much better if you do the lab first and then do the quiz. Do you understand what I mean? Okay, so there will be some standard question as just like general multiple choice with only words, but then a lot of it will be based on the models that you've done, you've seen in the lab PowerPoint activities. Do you guys with me with that on that? You know, because we're not in class, right? So I cannot physically see your reaction. Like, yeah, exactly, right? Whoever just gave me like a thumbs up in the chat box, that is much appreciated, right? So that way I can see if you guys are with me or not. Okay. So that is what the lab is. For each unit, you will do that PowerPoint thing and then you will go ahead and do the lab quiz. Now the lab quiz you will have 2 attempts, okay? You will have 2 attempts for the lab quiz and only the best score will be recorded, okay? So you study and then you do the lab quiz and let's say you get 70%, you're not happy with that, then study some more and then do it again. Say the second time you get 90%, then 90% is going to be the recorded mark for the lab, okay? So don't wing it. Okay, a lot of people in the past, they think, I'm just going to see what the questions are like and then just do it without studying, and then they waste a chance, right, basically, right? So please study accordingly before you you work on these things. So Stephanie asks, for the lab will be 1 hour to finish it. Okay. The lab quiz is 1 hour. That's right. Okay. But the actual lab, the PowerPoint thing that you do, there is no time limit, right? Because you don't have to hand it in. You can take as long as you want. Okay. Now 1 hour is very generous. Okay. Because as you can see, there are only 22 questions, right? Okay. So like I said, right, the lab is usually people get perfect on it, right? Together, all the labs, they account for like 10% of your final grade, right? So the purpose of the lab is just to help you boost your grade a little bit. Okay. And by the way, I think this goes without saying, but it's probably best if I say it explicitly. All the quiz and tests and the lab questions, they are all randomized. So you are not going to be getting the same test paper necessarily as your friend. Okay. So, you know, that minimizes a little bit of the cheating. Okay. They're like, no point of sharing your quiz with your friends, because they probably will get like another quiz. Okay. With different questions and different choices. So that is that. If you go to the content, we will start class soon. I just need to go through everything and make sure you know where to find things. If you go to unit one here, right, you see all the lectures. 1, 2, 3, 4. Sorry, I got another private message. Are there short answers for a test? Yeah, it's no short answers. Okay, everything is multiple choice. Okay, multiple choice for application questions. Standard multiple choice questions. And then for the multi-select question, it could be application questions, or it could just be like a regular questions. Okay. So you don't have to write anything for this course, which, you know, some people like that, some people don't like that. It is what it is. So if you click into each of the lecture, you will see the lecture PowerPoint. This is the actual PowerPoint file. Some people like to have that. If you want to print it out and you want to save paper and ink, you can print the 3 slides per page. After class, I will post the class note as well, because I'm not just going to read through the PowerPoints with you in class, okay? Like in a traditional classroom, you know, some of you will remember from last semester, I write a lot of things on the board, right? I will still be doing that, and then I will post that over here after class. As well, or maybe I'll create a separate folder for it. Okay, but I'll let you know. Okay, I'll create a link for it. There are study guide here. That's also what you need. You must download this and bring it to class, because we'll be using it quite extensively. There are some extra studying resources for you, right? So crosswords here, if you're into that sort of stuff. There are a lot of vocabularies for this course. Okay, so like, using these will help you. For example, the blank pericardium is the inner layer of the pericardium. Okay, so you will learn what that is called today. It's called a visceral. So you just type the answer here. And if you don't know what the answer is, that's fine. You can just click solve, and then it will show you what it is. Okay, so that is the excellent way of learning all the vocabularies and, you know, spelling them and so on and so forth. If I go back to study resources here, there are also self-quiz. Okay, so these are just formative assessment that you can do yourself. They do not count for anything. You can do them a couple times just as practice. I do want to mention that these questions are not necessarily the same level of difficulties as the quiz or test. These are much easier than what you expect. But nevertheless, they are a good place to start, all right, to see how much you know, if you want to just have some, you know, quick practice questions. There are some video resources. If I click on that, it will take you to a Padlet, which is just like a collection of videos I found on the internet, okay? So rather than you going on YouTube and, you know, wasting time looking for things, I did that part for you, okay? And then I just put everything here that people might find useful or interesting to look at, right? So we'll talk about blood circulation. OK, Okay, maybe you want to hear it from a different perspective, right? So you're welcome to use these videos as resources. Now, do keep in mind, this is an introductory course. So a lot of the videos that are available online, they go into much more detail than we would. And obviously, you are not responsible for all those extra information. Okay, so but just in case, right, you want to look at an animation, you want to hear the information from another person, the video resources are available to you here. If we go back to study resources once again, you will also have coloring sheets, okay? I think it's very important to use these coloring sheets as a studying tool for learning the body parts. Like the heart is pretty easy, okay? Like, you know, there's not too many labels to it. But once we get to like the brain, the eyes, the ears, and whatnot, right? You will have a lot of body parts to memorize. And one of the best ways to help you study is to use these coloring sheets, okay? The diagrams from the coloring sheets are embedded within the study guides. But, you know, if you want more sheets to practice or you just want to, you know, have a separate collection of them, you can download them there. Finally, there will be 3D models available every now and then. These are very useful tools as well. And I think they load okay on your phone as well, okay? And so, you know, you can move them around, you can click on them, and it will tell you what you're looking at. I'll be using some of these in class as well. So the site that I got them from is called BioDigital, okay? You can Google BioDigital Human, and then it will take you to that site. And all you need is like a Google account, okay? Like a Gmail account, okay? And then you can log in and then you would have access to it. The free version is a little bit limited. You know, it doesn't give you access to like all the diagrams and stuff like that. But, you know, it as far as free goes, I think it's pretty good. Like I didn't pay for it. Like, I also use a free version and I think it's enough for the purpose of this course, okay? I think I've covered everything I wanted to cover for the course. Any last minute question before we start the lecture?
I have a question.
Yes, please go ahead.
So for evaluations, there's no lockdown and a cheat sheet is allowed. Is that just for a quiz or is that for
everything? Everything for the whole course. Yeah.
Okay.
I personally don't believe in, you know, having too much restrictions when it comes to tests, right? I mean, you guys are adults, right? And the quiz and the test are designed in a way that you won't have an advantage even if you have all your notes in front of you. Now, having said that, I'm not saying that I'm deliberately making the test very difficult that you will all fail. That's not what I'm saying at all, okay? I'm saying, you know, if you study regularly as you would for in-person class, you will do just fine. Okay. Having the notes there might be psychologically beneficial for some of you, like having like a safety blanket, but don't fully rely on them. If you don't study and you know, just have the notes in front of you and then do the test, you will not do well in the course. Okay. And of course, if you have an ISP, right? If you register with the with CALS, and you need accommodation, like extra time and stuff like that, please send me the documents. And I will give you accommodation, you know, as required. Yes, please go ahead, Min. You have a question? See your hands up.
Well, we have after the tests, we have an opportunity to check our answers, like to see.
Oh yeah, that is an excellent question. Yep. So unfortunately, for everyone who teach this course, I'm only one of the teachers, right? We have three faculty teaching the course. We have come to an agreement that we will not be sharing the answers to the assessments. And I know that is not ideal for many of you. You know, you want to see where you got wrong and you want to learn from your mistakes, right? I understand that. But because it's an online course, we do have to protect the integrity of our test banks. So we don't want the questions to be out there, right? Because, you know, we know there are websites where people post their test papers and stuff like that. So just to, you know, minimize that kind of thing, we would not be returning the tests. Having said that, though, that's why the course is structured the way it is, right? You get quizzed on lecture one, but then test is only on 2, 3, and 4, right? So in a way, you don't have to really learn from your mistake, right? From quiz one in order to do well on test number one. I know that doesn't sound like very good logic, but you know, hopefully that kind of explains our rationale. Okay. Anyone else before we get started with the lecture? Okay. Now, if you have any concerns, right? Like, you know, if you get sick, you miss class, you need accommodation, whatever, right? Just send me an email. Okay. It's not a problem at all. For those of you who had me last semester, you know, I'm pretty easygoing person. You know, I am here to try to help you do well. I'm not here to make your life difficult. Certainly not trying to fail you. Okay. None of that concerns. So if you need anything, if you need extra help, if you need, you know, extensions or whatever, as long as you have a legitimate reason, I usually will try to accommodate the best I could. Okay, so again, the best way to reach me is my email, and my email is at the first slide of every PowerPoint slide. All right, so let's get started. In the first unit, we will be learning about the cardiovascular system. And then we'll be learning about blood, your immune system, and then we will be learning about the respiratory system. Okay, so those are the four things that we will do in unit one. And starting today, we will begin with the cardiovascular system. So let's learn about the major components of the cardiovascular system. Of course, the key component of the cardiovascular system is the heart, right? That is the main organ, right? That serves as the driving force to circulate our blood. Every time the heart beats, it squeezes blood throughout a network of blood vessels, and the blood vessels will then carry the blood throughout the body. Now, the type of blood vessel system that we have in our system is called a closed two-circuit circulatory system. So what does that mean? Well, closed means the blood will remain within the blood vessels at all times. Okay, it's not gonna leak out of it and, you know, go all over the place. Now you might think, hey, isn't that obvious? Like, of course the blood's gonna stay within the blood vessels, but you know, that's actually not necessarily true for all organisms. Some organisms, especially some of the bugs, right, insects, they kind of have a pool of blood, and then the cells just kind of bathe within them. Okay, so that's an open circulatory system. For us, right, mammals, for humans, we have a closed circulatory system. The blood remains within the blood vessels. Now, what does it mean by a two-circuit circulatory system? So let's take a quick note on that. If you have some paper, please pull it out and we can write this down. Okay, so let's talk about a single circuit. Okay, a one circuit circulatory system. Okay, so what does it mean? So if we think about something like a fish would have a single circuit circulatory system. Fish. So there will be the heart. They do have a heart, believe it or not. Then the heart will squeeze and it will pump the blood to their gas exchange organ. Okay? So fish, of course, they don't have a lung. What do they have instead? What's the gas exchange organ in fish?
Gills.
Gills, that's right. So the heart pumps the blood to their gills, where the blood will be oxygenated. They will pick up oxygen, and they will then continue onward to the body of the fish, okay, where the cells will use that oxygen for cellular respiration. And afterwards, the blood will go back to the heart, and the heart will pump once again to the gills, and so on and so forth. So this is a single circuit, one single loop. And the main disadvantage of that is after the blood goes through the gills, it actually lose pressure substantially and as well as speed, right? So it doesn't really move through the rest of the body as quickly as we would like it to be. But it's okay for the fish, okay? Because for the most part, fish, they are quite small and they're cold-blooded. And so they don't really require that kind of high pressure, high speed system. But something like this would be inadequate for a human. So that's why we would have a two circuit. Circulatory system. And we'll just put EG humans. Okay, so we have, again, we start at the heart. And then it's going to, you know what, let's put the heart right here. It's going to go to the lungs, where the blood will get reoxygenated. And again, I don't mean to nag, but I hope you're writing this down, because we're going to come back to these diagrams as we progress through the lecture. Now, instead of going to the body immediately after the lungs, like, you know, the fish did, it's going to go back to the heart. And then the heart will squeeze the blood, and this time it will go throughout your body, and then it will go back to the heart. Right? So that's one circuit, two circuit. Okay, and the blood never leaves the vessel. They stay within the vessels. That's why humans, we have a close two circuit circulatory system. Okay? Like I said, all these notes will be posted afterwards as well. Okay, so let's go back to the PowerPoint. Now, there are three types of vessels in our body. You probably are familiar with some of these. Okay? We have the arteries, and the arteries, they move blood away from the heart. Okay, A for artery, A for away. Okay, so the definition, right? By definition, we call a vessel an artery if it's carrying blood away from the heart. Okay, we do not define it based on what's inside the vessel. Okay, we define it based on, you know, whether it's carrying blood away from the heart or towards the heart. Oh, by the way, I've enabled live caption. So for some of you, you know, who needs that, you can turn it on in your Zoom as well. So after the arteries carry the blood away from the heart, they branch and become a little bit smaller. Right? These smaller versions of the arteries, they are called arterioles. After arterioles, they become networks of blood vessels called capillaries. Okay, so the capillaries, they are the smallest one, smallest blood vessels. Okay. And this is where gas exchange occurs, right? And afterwards, the capillaries will join together to form venules, which will then join together to form veins. Right? So venules are smaller versions of veins. And the veins, these are the ones that will be returning blood to the heart. I guess it kind of says it carries blood back to heart. Yeah, returning blood to heart, same thing. Right? So arteries away from the heart, veins returning them to the heart. Okay. Now, here are some of the major blood vessels that you have in the body, and you probably want to learn the names. So going up to the head, of course, is very important. We need blood to go up to the brain to, you know, keep our brain functioning and well-nourished. And the vessel that goes up to the head is called the carotid artery. Okay, if you use your two fingers and you place your fingers here, you can feel the pulse of the carotid artery. Okay, so it goes up, takes oxygenated blood to your brain, and when they use up the oxygen and wants to come back down, right, we have the jugular vein. Carotid goes up to the head, jugular brings it back down. The hand, right, you have a brachial artery here. You can kind of feel the pulse at where your elbow is, sort of, okay? So you put the finger there, and you will be able to feel the pulse of the brachial artery. And the one that returns to the heart, that's the brachial vein. You don't have to know this one. Okay, I won't ask you on that, but I just put it on in the notes here to I don't know why I put it there. Okay, but I'm not gonna ask you about the brachial. The other ones you have to know. Lungs, we have the pulmonary arteries and the pulmonary veins. Okay. The word, anytime you see the word pulmonary, it has something to do with the lungs. Heart, because the blood that's going through your heart chambers, they're actually going through it at very high speed and very high pressure, is not possible for the heart muscles to extract the oxygen from the blood that's passing through it, okay? And so it relies on a separate network of vessels for oxygen, and those are called coronary arteries and coronary veins. Okay? If you block your coronary arteries, you might have a heart attack. For kidney, it is called renal artery and renal veins. Your kidney actually filters 1.2 liters of blood per minute, okay? And so it needs a constant supply of blood to them. How much blood does a average person has anyway? Does anybody know? Like, let's say like average, adult. How many liters of blood do you think there are? Yeah, very good, right? Like five to six liters, depending on how big the person is, right? And 1.2 liters of it goes through the kidneys every minute. So that's quite a bit. Okay, that's like almost 20% of your total blood volume. The liver also does a little bit of filtering, although it is a different kind of filtering. And it is called a hepatic artery, hepatic vein. Okay, you might have heard of like hepatitis, right? Okay, so it's the same prefix. In anatomy, there are a lot of prefixes that would tell you which organ you're talking about, right? So pulmonary is lung, right? Hepatic, hepa, right? That's going to be the liver. So these are some of the major vessels that supplies different parts of the body, except for the hand one. The other ones that you should know them. So this was an old story that I clipped from, all the way from back from 2016. There was this lady, not this particular one, this is just a stock photo, but there was this lady who went to the salon and get her hair washed, and the angle of the headrest was not positioned properly. So her head was like tilted back a little bit too far than what it should have been. And that actually compressed her carotid artery. And as a result, she actually got a stroke while she was getting her hair washed because of the restricted blood flow that is going to the head. So something like that is quite dangerous. To avoid that, I guess just wash your own hair. It's much safer that way. Okay, let's move on to talking about the location of the heart and the different layers of the heart. And again, if I'm going too fast, if you have questions, please don't hesitate to ask. So where is the heart? Well, last semester, at the end of the course, you hopefully have learned about the different body cavities, right? Okay, so in the chest area, right, this is called the thoracic cavity. Okay, so the heart is within the thoracic cavity, and it lies beneath the sternum. Okay, so sternum is just the biology term for breastbone, which is this bone right here. Okay, that goes right down the center. So beneath that is where your heart is going to be, slightly to the left, of course. And the heart is situated between the lungs. And the apex of the heart, the apex is basically talking about the tip of the heart. The tip of the heart lies on the diaphragm and points slightly to the left of the body. So if you think about your, this is your body here, right? Okay, this is the thoracic cavity. And then you would have a diaphragm that separates the thoracic cavity from your abdominal cavity. And then so your heart is going to be right here. Okay, and the tip of the heart is going to be resting on the diaphragm. Okay. By now, you probably should know that the heart, I don't know who came up with this, but the heart doesn't actually look like that, right? Okay, show you the real heart later. I don't know who has decided that to use a symbol for the heart, but the actual heart actually looks nothing like that. Now, we don't want a heart to be like, you know, bouncing around in the thoracic cavity. So to protect it and to anchor it in place, the heart is surrounded by a double layer sac, double layer membrane called the pericardium. Okay. And there's a little bit of fat around the heart, and a little bit of fat is usually good for your organs. They serve two purposes. Number one, it helps insulate your organs, it keeps them warm, traps the heat. And number two, a little bit of cushioning, right, to protect your organs. Think of them as like bubble wraps that goes around, you know, things that that you buy, like electronics, right, come in bubble wraps. So if you drop them, it's not going to damage it. Similar concept here. The fat cushions the organs. So if you fall and, you know, bump yourself, that will protect the shock experienced by the organs. Okay, so there you go. That's where the heart is, and again, it's held in place and protected by the pericardium. So this is the professional drawing. You can see the diaphragm right here at the bottom, okay, separating the thoracic cavity from the abdominal cavity here. This halo that you see surrounding the heart, that is the pericardium here, okay, and the apex, which is right here. The apex, the tip of the heart points to the left side of the, points to the left side of the body. Now you might wonder, right, like, oh, how come this is the left side and this is the right side? When looking at it on the paper, like this clearly is the right and this is the left, right? Well, most of the diagrams that we'll be looking at is going to be the anterior view. Okay, you're going to be looking at the diagram from the front. Okay, so imagine looking at like my lungs, right? So my right is your left, right? And vice versa. That's why on a diagram with a front view, with an anterior view, the right side of the diagram is the left side. Okay, so please do remember that. And yeah, it's in between the lungs, like we said. This is what the actual heart looks like. You can see some of the blood vessels. Of course, they have been cut away. And all these, you know, gooey yellow stuff, those are going to be your fat tissue. Okay. And again, the fat is for insulation and for cushioning. Now, this next part is perhaps a little bit confusing. So try to stay with me. I'll draw a diagram for you to clarify afterwards. But the heart wall, right, if you take a slice of the heart, you will see that it's made up of three separate layers. Okay, so we have the endocardium, myocardium, and the epicardium. So the endocardium, this is the layer that is in direct contact with the blood. Okay, so the blood's going to be going through the heart and the heart's going to be squeezing them, and then the endocardium is a layer that will be in direct contact with the blood. And the endocardium is composed of what we call simple squamous epithelium, and you might remember learning about that last semester. All this means is that this is a single layer of flat cells. Okay, and these are, if you look at these squamous cells, they look like sunny side up egg, okay, like that. And then we have the, with the nucleus in the middle, and then you will have another one here, and then with the nucleus here. So the purpose of the simple squamous epithelium is that they create a smooth layer for the blood to pass through. Now, here's something to remember. We're going to come back to this next week. Blood blood does not like to pass through a rough surface. Anytime there's a rough patch, right, the blood is going to clot up, right? If you imagine like cutting yourself, right, having like a pierce cut or something like that, right, that actually damages the blood vessels and then expose rough surfaces in the blood vessels, and the blood start to clot. Right? It's like a defense mechanism, right? So you don't bleed out, right? So generally, the blood, they need to go through a smooth surface. And this simple squamous epithelium, this single layer of flat cells, creates that flat surface to allow the blood to pass through, smoothly. Okay, so that is the endocardium. Endo means within, right? Okay, so this is the deepest layer of the heart wall, the innermost layer, the deepest layer. Next, we have the myocardium. The myocardium is the thickest part of the heart wall, right? This is what makes up the muscle, right? Myo means muscle, okay? And the contraction of the myocardium is what propels the blood forward in your system. Outside of the myocardium is the epicardium. Right? The epicardium is the outermost layer of the heart wall. And this is the part where it might get a little bit confusing, okay? Which is also the inner layer of the pericardium. Do you remember the pericardium? We talked about this like two or three slides ago, right? The pericardium surrounds the heart, right? It's a two-layer sac that surrounds the heart. Okay, so the outer layer and the inner layer. Well, the inner layer of the pericardium is actually same as the epicardium. I'll draw you a diagram in a bit to help you understand this more. Okay, so endocardium, myocardium, epicardium, and the myocardium is the thickest one. Okay, think of it as like a burger. Okay, so you have your bread, buns, whatever you want to call them. And then you have your meat in the middle, okay, the patty. This is like a super big burger, okay? So that would be the endocardium and then the meat. That's the myocardium, and then you have your epicardium, okay? So this whole thing is called a heart wall, all right? Now, where does the pericardium fit in? Like, how does it work? All right, so let me just go to the... blackboard. I am going to lose all these things once I exit, so copy whatever you need to, and then I'm going to go back to the OneNote for a second. Okay, if you miss anything, you can just check the recordings later. Okay, so here's our heart wall. Let's try that one more time. Okay, so this is I know I said the heart doesn't look like that, but I can't help but draw it like that. Okay, so the heart is going to have like four chambers. I will tell you more about that later. Okay, but if I take a slice of the heart here, take a slice of it, okay, like that. This is where the blood will be. Okay, so that's the blood. Blood. And so right here on the inside, right here, directly touching the blood, what is the name of that layer? Okay, I mean, you don't have to answer me. You can just think about it in your head. What is the name of that layer? That is the endocardium. Hopefully that's what you said. And it's made up of a flat layer of cells called the squamous epithelium, right? Because blood likes smooth surfaces. Now, on the very outside, right here, that is going to be, what is that? Right here? Again, just think about it to yourself. Right? This would be the epicardium. Right? And in between, right here, All that muscle, all that meat, right? That would be the myocardium. Does that make sense? Like, are you guys with me so far? You can give me a hands up, a thumbs up if you could. Yeah, okay, I see a few. That's good. Okay. All right. Now, What's the deal with the pericardium? Okay, now, just go back to the overall heart, right? The pericardium goes around the entire heart, right? It's a membrane, it's a sac that goes around the heart, protects it, it anchors it, right? And it's a double layer, has two layers, right? So we have the outer layer right here, the pink one that I've drawn, right? Like this one. It's going to be on the next slide, but I'm going to write it down here. Okay, this is called a parietal pericardium. Okay, and then, you know what? Just give me 1 second. I'm going to redo that. And I hope you are drawing this with me, okay? I do a lot of drawings in this course. Okay. Do yourself a favor. Go buy some pencil crayons, okay? We're going to be doing a lot of colorings, a lot of labeling. So that's the parietal pericardium. And then right here, the epicardium is also part of the pericardium. But this one is like directly touching the heart. So we call that the visceral pericardium. Okay? And this is going to be a reoccurring theme, okay? Many organs have a membrane that goes around them. The one that's touching the organ, we call it visceral. And the one that's like further away, we call it the parietal. Okay, so the way I remember is like V for very close to the organ, visceral. Okay, which is the same as the epicardium, right? They are referring to the same structure. And then we have the parietal pericardium. So together, the parietal pericardium and the visceral pericardium, they make up the actual pericardium. Okay, which anchors the heart in place so they don't, you know, pop all over the place when it's beating, and it protects it. Now, in between, and I'm sorry with all these details, okay, that I'm throwing at you, but you do have to know them. In between the pericardium is going to be some fluid. Some lubricant that is called the pericardial fluid. It's important to lubricate the surfaces between the inner and the outer layer because every time your heart beats, right, the visceral and the parietal pericardium kind of rub against each other, and you need to minimize the friction. And that's what the pericardial fluid is. Otherwise, the friction will cause wear and tear. Right, inflammation, and we don't want any of that to happen. So the pericardial fluid is important in that regard. Do we have any questions regarding any of these before I move on?
Yeah, I have a question.
Yes, please.
Yeah, the visceral pericardium is also the epicardium.
Yes, yeah, yeah? It's the same name. Yeah,
that's same right. Name. Okay. Yeah. All right. Thank you.
And Sia, he says, so can I call visceral as endo? No, visceral is the epi. Okay, visceral is same as the epi. Yeah, that's right. Okay. So this guy, same. I don't know why they come up with two names. I guess it depends on what you're trying to talk about, right? If you're talking about the heart wall, then the epicardium is the outermost layer. If you're talking about the pericardium, though, then the epicardium or the visceral pericardium is the innermost layer, right? Do you see that? All right. I think I'll just go like another 15 minutes or so before we have a break. We will have a break, don't worry. But let's just keep going first. Okay. Everything here is what I told you already, but let's read through it. Why not? The heart is surrounded by a double layer membrane called pericardium. The inner layer is called the visceral pericardium / epicardium. We also know that, right? The outer layer, right? It's the parietal pericardium. And in between the visceral and the parietal, you're going to have the pericardial fluid. The purpose of the fluid is to act as a lubricant to reduce friction as the two layer rubs against each other when the heart beats. Okay, so these are all the information related to the diagram that I just drew for you. Hopefully it makes sense. Now, you might have heard of pericarditis before. Right? So anything that ends with like itis, I-T-I-S, means inflammation. Inflammation. So, you know, pericarditis is the inflammation of the pericardium. Hepatitis is the inflammation of the liver. Anybody else know any other itis? Just curious. Any other itis?
Patellar tendonitis?
Sorry, go ahead, Leah.
Patellar tendonitis. You can go, Min.
Right. Okay, yeah. And Min, did you say something else?
Laryngitis,
yeah. And then someone messaged me saying appendicitis. Yeah, so there is like a tons of stuff that can be inflamed, unfortunately for us. But all of my point is anything that ends with itis, right, is going to be inflammation, right? So this is the inflammation of the pericardium, and it's very painful. I mean, I haven't had it personally, but from, you know, what I've read, it's like stabbing pain, it says, because every time your heart beats, right, you would feel it. And people, again, this is all from the internet, people who have had this feel like they're gonna die because they thought they were having a severe heart attack, when in fact it's not. It's you know, the pericarditis, the inflammation, and this could be caused by bacterial infection, viral infection, and depending on the cause, right, you would need either antibiotics for bacterial infection, or you might need some antiviral drugs if it's a viral infection. All right, let's see how much you have learned from me so far. We're going to be doing polls quite often throughout the course, throughout the lecture. So please participate, right? I will launch the poll. And I know the question says select all correct answer, but this one only has one answer, right? Okay. It should be pretty straightforward. I mean, if you have been paying attention, you should be able to answer this no problem. Sometimes the poll doesn't work if you're, using your phone for the Zoom. That's okay. You can just, write down the answer yourself. Okay, only 12 of you answered, but that's okay. I'm just gonna end the poll. Most of you got it right. The vessel that carries blood away from the heart is the artery. A for away, right? The answer is A. Okay, artery. Let's try the next one here. Okay, thank you for participating. The correct answer is closed tube circuit, okay? Closed because blood stays within the blood vessels. Two circuits because it goes to the lungs, comes back to the heart, and then it goes to the body. So there's going to be like two loops as opposed to a single loop. The answer is B. Some of these questions will be on the quiz and test, okay? So make sure you pay attention to the answers and write them down accordingly. All right, let's see this one. Okay, and again, most of you got it right. The correct answer is pulmonary. Okay, and if you're not sure where to look for the answer, it is right here in this chart. All right, so the answer is B, pulmonary. Renal is for the kidney, hepatic is for the liver, and carotid is to go up to the head. Correct answer is pulmonary. One more. Very good. So muscle is the myocardium. Okay. Anytime you see myo, it has to do with muscle. Okay. Epicardium is the outer layer. That's part of the pericardium, the sac. Endocardium is the innermost layer that is touching the blood. Correct answer again is the myocardium, the thickest layer of the heart wall. You should also remember that. Okay. Thickest layer of the heart wall. Okay, moving on. We are going to label the heart shortly. But before we do that, let's just, you know, get our simple bearings and understand the major compartments of the heart. So first, we are looking at the heart here from the front, anterior view, which once again is the reason why the right side of the diagram is actually the left side of the heart. Okay, so on the left side, we have a top chamber and we have a bottom chamber. The top chamber is called the atrium, followed by the ventricle at the bottom. Right? On the other side, we also have the atrium and the ventricle. Okay, so the plural for atrium is atria, just so you know. Okay. In biology, sometimes we don't just add an S in the end for plural. It's weird. So atrium, the plural is atria. So you have two atria on the top, left and right, and you have two ventricles at the bottom. The right side of the heart is typically going to have oxygen poor blood. Let me see if I can change the color here. Right here. Okay, so this side, the right side of the heart, that is going to be oxygen poor blood. And on the other side, we are going to have oxygen rich blood. Okay, so we don't want to mix them. We don't want to mix the low O2 blood with the high O2 blood. And that's why we need to have a wall to separate them. So this wall that is right in the middle, that right here, that separates the two sides, that is called a septum. Okay. Have any of you heard of people who are born with like a hole in the heart? You might have heard that before. So, I mean, the hole can happen anywhere, but then very common, it happens right in the septum. So when there is a hole in the septum, then the blood will mix, okay? And you will not be able to circulate oxygen efficiently in the body. And that could contribute to, you know, sometimes what people call like blue babies, right? The skin has like a bluish hue to it. And that's because there's not enough oxygen in their blood. Partly could be due to a hole in the septum. I mean, there are other causes too, but then that's one of the reasons, one of the causes. All right, so right side of the heart, left side of the heart, and we have the septum in between. So let's label the diagram. And this is the part where you need to have your study guide. And so here's your study guide. And we're just going to go ahead and skip to the... this one right here. Okay. This is I don't know what page it is, but you know, if you keep on scrolling down, you'll get it. It's difficult for me to write the answer down here and then scroll up and down all the time. Okay, so I'm just going to label directly in the heart diagram here. You can do whatever you want. Okay, you can put the answers at the bottom. Some people like to just put all the answers here, and then they could easily cover them up and study with a blank diagram, right? But you know, whatever you want, doesn't really matter. Okay, so let's do this. Can I have a quick poll here? Do you have this diagram? Do you know where to find it? If you have it or know where to find it, please choose A. If you don't know where it is or don't have it, please choose B. I just want to see who has it and who doesn't have it before we proceed. Right, like if you just sit through this part and just watch it without copying, it's not going to be very useful. I keep on only getting like, you know, 13, 14 responses. Does that mean like there are 10 of you who are actually not here? You just sign on and then maybe you went somewhere else. In any case, I'll post a link for you. Okay, give me 1 second. Where is this thing? The study guide. Okay, I just posted a link in the chat box, so you can just click on that, and you will be able to find the study guide. Okay, so here we go. Let's label a few things before we take the break. Let's start with this thing right here, over here, number four. Okay, number four is referring to this chamber over here. This chamber. What is the name of that chamber? Please feel free to tell me the answer. Number four. You can type it in the chat box or you can unmute, whatever you want. What is number four? Yep, that's right. This is the right atrium. Right atrium. Okay. And that means on the other side, this right here, number 11, that would be the left atrium. Right atrium and left atrium. Below each of the atrium, you will have your ventricle. So number seven, let's talk about this whole space right here. That would be right ventricle. And number 16 on the other side, that would be the left ventricle. Okay. We want to separate the left side from the right side, right? So there's going to be a wall between them. What do we call that wall? What is the name of number 15?
Septum?
That is correct. That would be the septum. Thank you. We don't want any holes in the septum. That will cause the blood to mix on both sides and reduce our efficiency in distributing oxygen in the body. Okay. All right. Perfect timing. We're right at 9:45. Let's take a quick 5-minute-ish break. Okay. And we will resume at about 9:50. Okay. See you in a bit. Let's keep going. So we know that the heart has four chambers, and we already labeled them. The next thing we have to label would be all the vessels that are connected to the heart. So over here, this one, let's choose a darker color here. This one is called the superior vena cava and is responsible for collecting blood from the top around one third of the body and send it to the right atrium. Okay? This is the superior vena cava. I'll use blue for oxygen poor blood. Okay. Superior means on top, and then vena cava. Right. So if you think about the body, okay, your heart is located somewhere here, and so the superior vena cava will be collecting blood above this point. Okay, that's the superior vena cava. And then, of course, if there is a superior one, there will be an inferior vena cava, which will be collecting blood from the lower two-thirds of the body. Okay, so the inferior vena cava is going to be down here. Right. Inferior vena cava. I'm just going to put a star here. Maybe over here. Plural is vena cava. That's how you pronounce it. You add an E at the end. Like, I'm just telling you in case you read about it and then you see like an extra E there and you're like, you know, what's with the extra E, right? That's what it is, okay? So you have two vena cava, one superior, one inferior. That's what it means. All right. So both the superior and inferior vena cava will drain into the right atrium. And you can see here the opening of the superior vena cava. Can't really see the inferior one. Maybe a little bit of it right here. Okay. Right, so the blood's going to come up. Blood's going to come down. And then it's going to drain into the right atrium. Okay. It's going to fall into the right ventricle, and then it will get sent to your lungs through the pulmonary artery. Now, this is not the first time you've heard this name, right? In the key vessels that we saw on the table, on like the third slide or something, right? There is the pulmonary artery, right? Anytime you hear the word pulmonary, you know it has something to do with your lungs. Okay, so it kind of goes behind the aorta here. All right. And those would be your pulmonary artery. Again, I'm still using blue for sorry, give me a second. I'm still using blue for oxygen poor blood. So that's going to go right here. And that will be the pulmonary artery, taking the blood away from the heart. Okay, this one is the one on the right. I guess we can put right here. And number 10 is the left pulmonary artery. So, of course, this is going to go to the left lung. This is going to go to the right lung. All right. Why are we taking the blood to the heart? Well, the blood right now is low in oxygen, right? So we have to go to the lungs to get more oxygen, to get reoxygenation. Okay, so once you go to the lungs, the blood will get reoxygenated, and then they will come back. They will come back to the heart, and it will be through the pulmonary veins, which are number 12 here and number 3. So that would be, these would be oxygenated blood now. it would be high in O2 content. So left pulmonary vein and right pulmonary, pulmonary vein. And then you can see the two openings here for the left pulmonary vein, probably have two openings here as well. Okay, so the blood's gonna come in from both sides. Then it's gonna go down to the left ventricle, and then we'll give it a big squeeze. Everything will go through the aorta. What other color have I not used yet? Let's use this one. Aorta right here. Ooh, it looks very similar to the purple one, but you get it. Okay. Now, I want you to visualize this. This part is requires a little bit of imagination, okay? This arches back, and it actually is going to continue downward like that behind the heart. And you can't really see it, right, because it's blocking it. But then it would exit down here. Okay, like that. Do you understand what I mean by that? Right, like actually comes right here like that. Okay, so the blood goes up, arches down, continues behind the heart, and then it will come down like that. Okay, so this is called the aorta. Aorta. Biggest vessel, biggest blood vessels in the heart. It's going to arch back here, and it's going to continue to the abdomen. It actually will go through. It will go through this thing. Anybody know what this line is? What did I just draw right here? Think about it.
Diaphragm?
That is the diaphragm. Thank you. Okay, so it's going to go through the diaphragm, and then it's going to become the abdominal aorta. Which will branch into the renal arteries and goes into your kidneys. But we'll learn about kidneys later on in the course. Okay. Like I just want you to know that it actually comes down. Right? Some people, you know, think that it goes to the back and, you know, where does it go? It disappears. It actually does come down at the bottom. In terms of the little stuff right here, these little guys, right? This one of them will go supply the blood to the right side of your body. This is going to go up to your head. This is going to go to the left side of the body. Okay, so this will go to the head. To head, which means it will become the carotid artery. Okay, this goes to the left side of the body. The right side. Right body. Supply the right arm with oxygenated blood. It becomes your right brachial artery. This goes to the left side of the body. Okay. Any questions so far? I know I still have four labels here, but are we good? All right. Let's go back to the lecture for a second and see if we've missed anything. Okay, so this is just a description of all the vessels that we've labeled. You probably can read that on your own. Okay, I'm not going to read it to you now. Okay, we'll go back to the diagram. I know we still have four labels, but we'll go back to it later. Let's talk about the circulatory circuits, right? So there are two major circuits. You should not be surprised by now. You already know we have a close two-circuit circulatory system, right? So it turns out the circuits has names. We have the pulmonary circuit and the systemic circuit, okay? Rather than reading this to you, I'm just going to go back to our note here and explain it Right, so back to our diagram right here, the two circuit that we drew over here. Right, so this one, it is called the pulmonary circuit. Pulmonary circuit. Well, because we go into the lungs, everything related to the lungs is pulmonary. So that's pulmonary circuit. The other one that goes to the body, that is the systemic circuit. Okay, systemic means bodily. Yeah, so that's the two circuits. The purpose of the pulmonary circuit is, of course, to reoxygenate the blood, to add oxygen to the blood, right? And that, of course, happens at the lungs. So at the lungs, you would have O2 added and CO2 removed, right? Okay, the O2 goes into the blood, CO2 leaves the blood. In the body, it's the other way around. The oxygen will leave the blood and goes into the body. Okay, and then the CO2 will enter the blood. I'm talking about like from the perspective of the blood, right? I know what the diagram looks like, saying the oxygen is leaving the body and the CO2 is entering the body, but I'm talking about from the perspective of the blood. This whole diagram is related to the blood. So at the lungs, the O2 enters the blood and leaves, the carbon dioxide leaves the blood. In the body, right, at the bodily cell, right, the O2 will leave the blood for the body cells to use, and the carbon dioxide that is generated from the tissue as a result of cellular respiration, that will go into the blood. Okay, so again, I'm talking about it from the perspective of the blood. So that's the two circuits. So the purpose of the pulmonary circuit, as I said, is to reoxygenate the blood. It's in the PowerPoint anyway, you can look at that later. And the purpose of the systemic circuit is to distribute that oxygen in your body. So tell me, please, what blood vessel should I put here from that connects the heart to the lung? Now let's think about that for a second. Connecting the heart to the lungs. Let's look at your heart diagram and see what's the appropriate vessel is to put here.
Pulmonary artery?
That is correct. Thank you. That is the pulmonary artery. And again, I'm using blue because at this point, the blood is still oxygen poor, right? Okay, it is low in oxygen. But once you go through the lungs, it will become oxygenated, and then it will be the pulmonary veins that brings it back to the heart. So that completes our pulmonary circuit. On the other hand, right, we would have the heart that pumps the blood through the aorta. And of course, the aorta would branch into all these smaller vessels, right? The arterioles, non-capillaries, and supply the entire body with oxygen. And when it's all said and done, all the blood will go back to the heart through the venae cavae. Right? Superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, and it goes back to the heart. So that is your two-circuit circulatory system. All right. Okay, moving on. This diagram kind of shows you what it's like. So I know you cannot see any of the labels like on my screen, but you know, you can zoom in on your own. But here's what the most important point is. We start at the right atrium here. Let me just change my color. There we go. Okay, so this is the right atrium. Oh, you can't see that. I don't want to use red and blue because it might confuse you with the oxygen content. So this is right atrium. This is right ventricle, right? So starting in the right atrium, you will go into the right ventricle, and then the blood will go to the lungs and come back, right? It will go to the other side as well and come back. So this orange loop that I just did, that would be the pulmonary circuit. Okay. And starting at the right ventricle, right atrium rather, it will go into the right ventricle. And there are many separate circuits, right? That is part of the systemic circuit. Depends where you want to go, right? So the aorta goes up and then it will go to the head and then it will come back. So that's part of your head systemic circuit. And then the aorta, of course, continues to go down through the abdominal aorta. And then it might go to different places. It might go to your guts. It might go to your kidney. It might go to your intestines. It might go to your legs, and so on and so forth, right? So all these different paths, they are all part of your systemic circuit. Okay? So the pulmonary circuit would turn the blood from blue to red, so to speak, and you reoxygenate it. For the systemic circuit, it would turn it from red to blue because you are, you know, using the oxygen in your tissue, right? They are not actually blue, right? I have to tell you that. Someone actually asked me that before. Oxygenated blood is brighter, and then oxygen poor blood is darker. Like if you buy thank you, Elvin. Student just messaged me, told me I made a mistake here. That is the left. Thank you. Left, not the right. Thank you. What was it saying? If you buy like ground beef, for example, like it's red on the outside, but then like once you break it apart, the ground beef that are like closer to the center, they are like darker brownish, right? Okay, so that is because the blood in the center was not exposed to the air, and so they are not oxygenated. That's why they are the color they are. But if you leave them on the counter for a bit, they will eventually become a brighter color as they soak up the oxygen in the surrounding. So similar situation with our blood. If it's oxygenated, it's bright red. If it's oxygen poor, then it's like a brick brownish color. All right. If you ever had blood taken from you, you would know what the color of the blood is, right? Is the blood that is being taken from you, generally speaking, the ones that you see the nurse take from you, is that venous blood or is that arterial blood? Is that blood taken from the vein or from artery? What do you think? Let's do a poll. Why not?
From the vein.
From the vein. Yeah. Okay. Anyone else? Let's see. I just want to see what you guys think. If you think it's, you know, regular blood that is drawn from you, if you think it's from the artery, please choose A. If you think it's from the vein, please choose B. Yeah. Okay, good. Most of you said the vein, right? That would be correct, right? You know, all the blue lines that you see on your skin, you can't really see it through the screen, okay? But those are the veins, right? Veins are usually closer to the surface of the body. It's the arteries that are very deep in the body, right? So the color of the blood that comes out, right, from your vein, that's the deoxygenated blood color, right? Sometimes people do have to take blood from arteries, but the nurse needs like a special license to do that. They need special training to do that. Why is it dangerous to take blood from an artery? Anybody want to, you know, guess or you know, share? Why do you think it's more dangerous to take blood from artery?
It's
more dangerous, right, but why? Anybody know?
I'd say because like it's bigger, right?
Okay, so it's bigger, yeah. Okay, and Min Chu said it causes blood clotting. Okay, yeah. Yeah, I mean, like all of those are part of the reasons, but you know, you can't really see the arteries, right? That's another thing, right? Because they are so deep, right? All again, all the blue stuff that you see on your hand, those are the veins. So it will be more difficult to locate them. Number one, and number two, as we will learn soon, the pressure in the artery is really high, right? So if you damage it accidentally, then you know you might have bleeding all over the place. You know how in movies, right? Like when someone damaged like an artery, the blood just kind of squirt all over the place. Like if you watch like a war movie or something like that, right? We don't want uncontrolled bleeding. We don't want to not be able to stop the bleeding, right? And so you know, typically we take blood from the veins. Sometimes you take blood from the artery if you need to measure, say, the oxygen level or something like that. But generally, from the veins. Probably not going to interfere with the blood traveling too much. And if you just insert it and come back out. But I see why you would say that. Okay, moving on. Where are we now? Okay, yeah, so these are like heart pictures that I took when I was in university. I had to take an anatomy course, and you know, they had real hearts for us to look at, like human hearts that has been preserved. I remember taking a picture to study them. So that is the aorta. You can see it's really, really big. Like in fact, if I put my thumb into there, it would have a lot of wiggle room. Okay, so that's how big the aorta is. Next to it, you have the pulmonary artery, which is comparatively smaller. You can see the wall is also less thick, right? Because there is not as much pressure going through it. So you don't need as thick of a wall. I didn't know what that was. I still don't really know. I think it's the pulmonary veins, possibly. It's hard to tell from this angle. And this is kind of like the beige color once you drain all the blood. Okay, so that's another diagram. This is taken from the back. I've asked my partner to put the fingers into the superior vena cava and the inferior vena cava here. And the fingertips are actually touching inside. So what chambers would the fingertips be touching within here? You guys know? Oh, actually, it says right here. It's the right atrium. That's a spelling mistake back then, but it's A-T-R-I-U-M, right? Because the blood from the vena cava actually drains into the right atrium, okay? And again, you see the aorta here. There's a pulmonary artery and all these gooey stuff. That's the fat I was telling you about, right? Okay. So fortunately for us, we only have to label like nice colored diagrams that are easy to tell. Something like this would be very difficult to tell when it's not color coded. All right, moving on. The next thing we're going to talk about is the heart valves, right? So within the heart, there are four valves. And the main function of the valves is to prevent backflow of blood. We want to maintain like a one-way traffic system in the blood vessels, okay? We don't want the blood to go back because number one, you might end up mixing the blood. Okay, the oxygenated blood and the oxygen poor blood, we don't want to mix them, right? And going backwards risks doing that. And secondly, it would create too much turbulence, right, in your system. The heart pumps goes forward, and imagine if some of them go backwards, it would clash with the forward moving blood and slow them down, right? So we want to make sure things only go forward in our system and not back. And the way to do it is to have these one-way valves throughout the system. So there are two sets of valves here. We have the atrioventricular valves as well as the semilunar valves. So atrioventricular valves are located between the atrium and the ventricle. So you have one on the left side and one on the right side. Okay, we can call them AV valves, atrioventricular valves. And then the other one is called the semilunar valve. So let's label them on our diagram first, and then we'll come back to talk more about it. And so back to the study guide over here, number six. I will use a different color. If you could, please do the same. I'll tell you why later. Okay, so right here, number six, talk about this this valve here, this one is on the right side and it separates the right atrium from the right ventricle. Okay, and we call that the tricuspid valve. Tricuspid. Okay, it has three flaps. That's why it's called tricuspid. Like a tricycle has three wheels, triangle has three sides. Tricuspid has three flaps. Okay, so the tricuspid valve on the right side. And on the other side, number 14, that is the bicuspid. Bicuspid. Or sometimes if you read older textbook, it might call them mitral valve. Okay, so this one has two flaps as opposed to three flaps. Okay, so both of these, the orange ones, they are the atrioventricular valve. Okay. Three flaps on the right, two flaps on the left. Tricuspid and bicuspid. I'll explain more in a bit. Let's label the other two. Let's use purple. This one is located at the entrance to the pulmonary artery. That's called the pulmonary valve. Number five, right here. Pulmonary valve. And then you have one right here that is at the entrance of our aorta. Oops, I did a poor job coloring earlier. That's also part of the aorta. Okay, like the blood goes up here, right? Like that. That is the aortic valve. Okay. So the orange ones, they are the AV valves, and the purple ones, Sammy Luna, the person who named them, decided that they look like half moons. That's why they're called semilunar valve. Okay, pulmonary valve, aortic valve, semilunar. All right. So that's everything on the diagram. All right. Keep this handy if you could. And we're just going to go back to here in the study guide. So like you should work on the study guides in between classes, right? Okay, so something like this, you probably will be able to fill out just using the PowerPoint, right? I mean, we'll fill in as much as we could, as much as time allows, but you should also be doing it on your own. So let's take a look at this one. The superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, and we're just going to fill in the appropriate parts. Okay, actually, I'm going to give you maybe 3 minutes or so to try this on your own. Okay, so you can flip back and forth with the other diagram and just try to fill it in. So for example, the superior inferior vena cava, it will feed into the right atrium, right? In the right atrium. And then it's going to go through a valve, it says here, and then to the next chamber and so on and so forth. So I just want to give you like maybe 2-3 minutes just to try that on your own, and then we're going to take that up. Okay. Okay, let's take it up. So after the right atrium, it is going to go through the tricuspid valve, the one that has three flaps on the right side. And then the blood will drain into the right ventricle. from the right ventricle, it will go through the pulmonary valve and enters the pulmonary artery. Then the blood goes to the lungs. They get reoxygenated. Then they will come back through the pulmonary vein. That takes the blood back to the left atrium. And then it will go through the bicuspid valve. And into the left ventricle. The left ventricle will give it a squeeze and it will go through the aortic valve. And then finally to the aorta. And of course, the aorta will distribute the blood throughout the body. And then it will go back to the heart through the vena cava. So let's just highlight them again, right? So starting at the superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, it's going to be blue for oxygen poor blood. Still blue. Okay, we're going to skip the valve. And then it's going to be blue all the way until you get to the lung, right? At the lungs, we will add oxygen to it, so it becomes red or pink in this case. Pulmonary veins, take them back to the left atrium, skip the valve, left ventricle, aorta. And then at the body, it will turn from pink to blue again as the oxygen leaves the blood. So over here, that is for O2 poor. And that is for O2 rich. The valves, let's highlight them as well. We have the tricuspid valve on the right side and the bicuspid valve on the left side. What do we call these two? Tricuspid, bicuspid, collectively? What do we call them? Just think about it in your head. Hopefully you...
Atrioventricular valve.
Yeah, that's the right one. Thank you, Shelley. That is the AV valve. And the other one... I think I used purple for the other one, right? In the other diagram. The aortic valve and the pulmonary valve. That would be the semilunar valve. Everybody with me? Everybody happy? Are we together? So, what's the point? What's the point of the valves? Well, let's take a look. So generally, right, a valve, the general function is to prevent backflow of blood, right? We know that already. That was from the PowerPoint. But, you know, backflow to what? If you look at this diagram, all you have to do is to see what is before a particular valve to see what the function of that valve is. So what is the function of the tricuspid valve? Well, the function of a tricuspid valve is to prevent the backflow of blood to the right atrium. Yeah, so you don't want the blood to go back to the right atrium. That's what this valve is for. What about bicuspid valve? It will be preventing backflow of blood to the left atrium. Okay, so generally, AV valves prevents the blood from going back to the atria. Whereas the pulmonary valve and the aortic valve, the semilunar, they will prevent backflow of blood to ventricles. Yeah, you see the ventricle is before each of the semilunar valves, right? So again, to see what the valve does, you just look at the thing before it, the structure before it. That's what you're trying to prevent the backflow to. All right. So let's go back to here. And it's basically what I just told you. Okay, so I'm going to skip through that. This is what I told you as well. Like you can read through it later, right? But I already discussed it. Okay, so this is the next thing that you should be aware of. This diagram on the left is a transverse section, which means you take the heart and you slice it like that. You slice it in the top and bottom portion. And then we're looking at it from the top. So we can see the tricuspid valve here. So, you know, one flap, two flaps, three flaps, right? Tricuspid valve. And the bicuspid valve here. So the way that these valves operate is that the AV valves would open and closes together. Okay, so tricuspid, bicuspid would either open together or close together. And same thing with the semilunar, they will close and open together. However, the two pair of valves will operate out of sync. So when the AV valves are open, as shown in the picture here, the semilunar valves will be closed. When it's time for the semilunar valves to open, then the AV valves will close. Okay? So if it's the same category, they would be in phase. They would be in sync, either both open or both closed. But it will always be out of sync to the other pair. Do you understand that? Right. So when AVs are open, the semilunars are closed. Well, why is that? Let's think about what happens when the AV valves are open. Right. So the blood will go from the atria on the right side and the left side, and then it will fall down into the ventricles below. Right. So think of the AV valve think of the tricuspid valve and the bicuspid valve as like the floor, right? So as soon as the floor opens, and all the blood will go down from atria into ventricles, right? Okay. Gravity does most of the work, right? The atria hardly has to squeeze, right? We just go down and it will fill up the ventricles, okay? We do not want the blood to go into the pulmonary artery or the aorta prematurely. We don't want the blood to move forward to the lungs, to the body, before the ventricles are completely filled up. That's why we have to close the pulmonary valve. That's why we have to close the aortic valves, right? We close the exit. We make sure all the blood from the atria will fill up the entire ventricle first before we send them forward. That's why when the AV valves are open, you have to close the semilunar. Okay? When do we close the AV valves? We will close them when the ventricles on the right side and the left sides are filled up. Once they're filled, then the ventricle will squeeze. When we squeeze the ventricles on both sides, right, we want to make sure there is only one place for the blood to go. If we are on the right side, we want the blood to go through the pulmonary artery. If we are on the left side, we want the blood to go through the aorta. Okay, so when the ventricle squeezes, we have to open the semilunar valves to allow them to go into the respective vessels. We have to close the AV valves because otherwise the blood would just squirt back into the atria, right? We don't want that. We want the blood to go forward, not backwards. That's why when you open the semilunar, you must close the AV valves. Does anybody have any question about that? Okay. Furthermore, when the AV valve are closed, right, the atria will be filling with blood, okay, either from the pulmonary circulation or from the systemic circuit. Okay, and then when the ventricles is completely empty, then it's time for the semilunar to close again. And then the blood that was filled up previously will now drop into the ventricles. Okay, and then the whole thing repeats itself. I hope that makes sense. Do some more pulls. Go ahead, please. Yeah, most of you got it right. It is the superior inferior vena cava. It collects the blood from the top part of the body and the bottom part of the body through the systemic circuit, and then it will return it to the right atria. Let's try the next one. The correct answer is the pulmonary vein. If you're not sure, you can just look at the diagram we just fill in the blanks that we just did, right? And look at what is red and what is blue, right? So oxygen rich is the pulmonary vein. We are returning from the lungs in the pulmonary veins, freshly reoxygenated. Okay, so that's the correct answer. How about this one? Bicuspid valve is the correct answer. Okay. So on the left side, separating the left atrium and the left ventricle is the bicuspid valve, and it will prevent backflow to the left atrium. Just for the record, the tricuspid valve would prevent backflow to the right atrium. Pulmonary valve would prevent backflow to the right ventricle, and the aortic valve would prevent backflow to the left ventricle. So the sound that you hear, using a stethoscope, that's what this is caused by the closing of the heart valve. Okay? So every time the valve closes, it creates a sound. So the first sound that you hear is caused by the closing of the AV valve. Most people describe it as a lub, and then the dub would be the closing of the semilunar valve. Okay? So it's like, closing a door. When you slam a door or close, it creates a sound. When you close the valves, it creates a sound. Okay, so the lub and the dub. Sometimes the doctor might be able to hear additional sound in addition to the lub and the dub. Okay, so you're supposed to hear like the clear lub and dub and nothing in between, okay? But sometimes the doctor might hear additional sounds. So these additional sound is called a heart murmur, okay? Heart murmurs. That's as a result of turbulent blood flow. Remember, blood is supposed to just go one way with very little turbulence, okay? But sometimes there are abnormalities that could create additional turbulent flow, then that creates the extra sound, the heart murmurs. Some examples that could result in heart murmur includes things like regurgitation. And so regurgitation means, if a person regurgitates, it means they throw up, right? Okay, but in the context of a circulation, regurgitation is usually caused by a leaky valve. Leaky valve. Okay, so the valve is supposed to close. Over here, we're looking at the tricuspid valve. And when the ventricle contracts, like it's not going to be able to go back, right? That's the whole point of having a valve. But in some cases, if the valve is not closing properly, then the blood will go backwards. And remember, when the ventricles are squeezing, what normally is happening is that the atrium is being filled up with blood. So the blood that are coming in from the vena cava will now be mixing with the blood that's squirting back from the right ventricle because of the leaky valve. And that creates turbulence. And you can hear that from a stethoscope. Okay. So what can cause a leaky valve? Does anybody know? You might either read about it, you've heard about it, or you know someone who has a leaky valve. What might be some of the causes for that? No, that's okay. It could be congenital. Okay, that means the person is born with a leaky valve. That's quite common, more common than you would imagine. Even if you're not born with it, in adults, it's possible to have a leaky valve as a result of inflammation. Okay, you might have heard of like endocarditis, right? Okay, COVID vaccine and stuff like that. Some of them, like the AstraZeneca one, right? One of the possible side effects is to have the inflammation. And those inflammation sometimes can cause the heart valves to become a little bit swollen, and they don't close properly. Okay, so that is the one cause of heart murmur. Stenosis. Stenosis is another one. That is the narrowing of blood vessel. Right, so that's a normal blood vessel. And sometimes you might have like stuff that are building up on it. Okay, that causes it to become narrow, and that create like turbulent flow, and heart murmur can occur. And finally, you can have a cardiac shunt. Right? A shunt is, in the simplest term, is basically a connection between two parts that normally are not connected. Okay. I'll give you an example in a bit. The key point here is all these three things, the regurgitation, the stenosis, and the shunt, they all create turbulent flow, which could then result in the heart murmur. So heart murmur is itself not like a disease or condition. Well, it's a condition, I guess, but it's not necessarily like a disease, right? Like you have to find out what is the cause of the heart murmur. And then you will have to treat it. Some heart murmurs are, they're called like innocent heart murmur. It means they don't have any underlying problems, okay? It will go away on its own. And that's one of the things that, you know, the doctor would check when babies are born, right? The first thing they do is they listen to the heart and see if they have any heart murmurs. My younger daughter, when she was born, actually the nurse sat on the spot. Well, they were talking to another nurse. They wasn't talking to me. There's one nurse who was checking the heart with the stethoscope. She said to another nurse, there is a heart murmur. Okay. So like immediately I got very concerned, right? But after doing some tests, it turns out it's an innocent heart murmur, and then it just went away when she grows up. So sometimes it's not as innocent. Sometimes it is quite serious. So there's something called like ductus arteriosus. Okay, so this is like a normal connection in the fetus. Fetus is like when the baby is growing in the mother, right? It's a shunt as a connection between the pulmonary artery and the aorta. Okay, so the fetus does not have to breathe on its own, right? Because the mother is doing the breathing for the baby. So that's why there is like very little purpose, little very reason to send the blood to the baby's lung. Okay, so this ductus arteriosus, this shunt, allows the blood to bypass the lungs and go directly to the aorta. Okay, because the blood will be oxygenated through the placenta, right? Okay, there's no need to go to the baby's lung. So something like that is supposed to close when the baby is born. Okay, but in some cases it doesn't close for whatever reason, and if it doesn't close, then we have a problem with the baby, because we actually do need to send the blood to the lungs once the baby is born. You know, the baby needs to do its own breathing, right? So having this shunt not close in a baby would cause oxygen poor blood to go directly into the aorta, and that could cause the baby to have some kind of anemia, right? Like symptoms, because they're not going to be able to distribute oxygenated blood properly. And you would be able to hear the heart murmur because of the turbulent flow created by this shunt. Okay. All right. Let's just do another 15 minutes, and then we are gonna call it a day. All right. So just hang in there. Next thing we're gonna talk about is the concept of cardiac output. Cardiac output. So cardiac output, by definition, is how much blood is pumped by the heart every minute. Okay? Volume of blood pumped by the heart per minute. That's what cardiac output is. It's an indication of heart function and the condition of the heart. Right? Having a good cardiac output indicates that you have a healthy heart. Okay? So it's something that people do measure. And to calculate the cardiac output, we need two pieces of information. We need the heart rate, which is, you know, beats per minute, how many times your heart beats. And usually the heart rate for a normal person, you know, ranges from 70 to 80. If you are physically active, you know, your resting heart rate could go as low as, like, you know, in the mid 50s to the low 60s. Okay, you know, typically speaking, we're talking about 70 to 80 beats per minute. And we will multiply the heart rate by the stroke volume. Okay, stroke volume is how much blood is squeezed out by the heart per beat. Okay, so that's usually is around 60 to 80 milliliters per beat. Okay, so heart rate multiplied by stroke volume. And if you remember fraction from math, you would reduce the beat, and then you get volume per minute. Okay. There are different factors that would affect your heart rate. You don't have to memorize this. But for example, your hormones, right? If you have adrenaline in your system, right, that would speed up your heart rate, which would in turn increase your cardiac output. Your fitness level, right? I talked about that already. If you regularly exercise, your resting heart rate is probably lower. Age, right? Younger people, you know, in their adolescence would have a better heart rate, lower heart rate than people who are older. And newborns, like babies or infants, their heart rate is really, really fast, right? Compared to like a teenager, for example. Fat factors that affects the stroke volume, the size of the heart. Some people have bigger hearts than others, and they're able to squeeze out more blood. And is also possible for the heart to grow bigger as a result of certain conditions. Long-term smokers, for example, they have, we call it hypertrophy. Okay? Hypertrophy is when an organ gets bigger. So the heart gets bigger because it tries to distribute more oxygen to compensate for the reduced respiratory function, right? So that could affect the stroke volume. Fitness level, again, the more you exercise, right, the heart can get bigger in some cases to, you know, mediate the blood circulation, right? Gender, so on and so forth, okay? The point is there are many factors that could affect your heart rate and stroke volume, and so your cardiac output is not a fixed number, okay? It will change depending on depending on what you're doing, depending on your age, depending on your fitness level, and so on and so forth. But the cardiac output is nevertheless a useful indicator of how healthy your heart is. So let's do a sample question here in the study guide. Sorry, they're kind of all over the place, but I'm sure you will find them when you're doing it. This is question number 10. So a patient has a breathing rate of 30 breaths per minute and a heart rate of 70 beats per minute. If their stroke volume is 80 milliliters per beat, calculate the cardiac output. Okay, so the breathing rate here is absolutely useless. We do not need that. The formula is cardiac output equals to heart rate multiplied by stroke volume. And so the heart rate here is 70 beats per minute multiplied by 80 milliliters per beat. And so 70 times 80 is 5600 milliliters per minute. Right? You can see the beat cancels out, right? So we can say 5,600 milliliters per minute, or sometimes it is expressed as liters. Right? You probably learned this from math. To go from milliliters to liters, you would divide by 1,000. So that is how you calculate the cardiac output. So let me ask you, when you are exercising, does your cardiac output increase, decrease, or no change? Let's do a poll for that. When you are exercising, do you expect your cardiac output to increase, decrease, or no change?
What are the options? A for
increase. A for increase, B for decrease, yeah. And then C for no change. Yeah, most people got it right. When you are exercising, you increase your heart rate. If you increase your heart rate, you will increase your cardiac output because you're multiplying by a bigger number, right? Hey, what about recovering? Recovering from heart attack. What do you think? If you're recovering from a heart attack, do you expect the cardiac output to increase, decrease, or no change? Decrease would be correct, because a heart attack causes the heart muscle to become weaker, right? Okay, so if the heart muscle is weaker, it would not be able to squeeze as hard, and the stroke volume would decrease in that case. If you lower the stroke volume, you will in turn lower the cardiac output. Okay, so hopefully that makes sense. Okay, let me see what else we have here. Let's do a few more slides. So next, we will talk about the cardiac cycle and the rhythm. Does anybody know what's drawn here in the picture? What is this thing? This is a chest X-ray, and you know, you can see the ribs here. And you know, what is that thing?
Is it a pacer?
Is that a pacemaker?
Yeah, that's right. That is a pacemaker, a pacer, right? The function of the pacemaker is to help set your own, set your heart rate for you when your own natural mechanism fails. Okay, so we're going to learn how the heart actually sets its own rhythm, and you know, when that fails, that's when you need the pacemaker. So what is a cardiac cycle? A cardiac cycle includes everything that happens during one heartbeat. Okay, the atria squeezes, and then the ventricles squeezes, okay? But never together, right? It's always atria first, and then ventricle follows. So squeeze, squeeze, okay? Now listen carefully, right? Try to write down some of these things. When the atria contracts, we talked about how the AV valves will open, right? So the blood will go down. When the AV valves open, the semilunar valves will close. Okay, so when atria contracts, the ventricles are filling up with blood. When the ventricles is completely filled up, then it's time for the atria to relax. And then the ventricle will squeeze, opening up the pulmonary valve and the aortic valve, right? And at the same time, we close the AV valve. So when atria contracts, ventricles will be relaxing. When ventricles contract, the atria will be relaxing. Fancy word for contracting is called systole. Relaxation is called diastole. You might not recognize these words, but then you probably have heard of like systolic pressure and diastolic pressure, right? You know, the famous 120 over 80, right? So, you know, systole or systolic pressure is the pressure that you measure when the heart is contracting. And diastolic pressure is the one that you measure when the heart is relaxing. Okay, so when the atria is undergoing systole, the ventricles will be undergoing diastole. Okay, contraction, relaxation. So the conduction system of the heart, right? So we have the SA node, which is also called a natural pacemaker, and we have the AV node. Okay, so I'm just gonna go to another diagram here in your study guide, and we're just going to label some of these things, okay? So this over here shows the conduction system of the heart. You might remember this here, this vessel, that's the superior vena cava. Okay, and it's going to be coming in to the right atrium, and located at the top of the right atrium, that's where you will find the SA node, okay, the natural pacemaker of the heart. Okay, so it's a cluster of cells, it's a group of cells that sends out electrical signal. Right, we call them impulses, okay? Electrical signals that will spread throughout the heart. When the signal gets to a particular chamber, that chamber will contract, right? The myocardium, the muscle of that chamber, will contract. And so the SA node will periodically send out signal to cause the heart to beat, basically. Now we the essay, no, I should mention it is under the influence. Under the influence of the nervous system, which we'll learn later on in unit two. Okay, like you don't have to remember to beat your heart for the heart to beat. Okay, your brain automatically does that for you, probably for the better, right? Like we don't want to forget and suddenly drop dead, right? So the nervous system will control that for you. So you have no voluntary control over your SA note. But you can do things to influence your SA note. So give me some examples, okay? Just type them in the chat or yell them out. What are some of the things that you could do to maybe increase the firing of the SA note so it sends out signal quicker? Okay? What are some of the things that you can do right now, you know, in your room that would cause the SA note to fire faster?
Exercise?
That's right. You can stand up and do some jumping jacks, right? And after 10 or 20, your heart rate goes up, right? So exercise will cause the SA note to fire faster, increases the frequency, right? So things that you could do to influence it, right? Like exercise. Okay. Anything else that could change it? Right? Increase it, slow it down. Anyone else? What can you do to change your heart rate? Panic, that's right, panic. Right? When you are panic, it's like, oh, I forgot my calculator on the math test. Oh no, your heart rate might go up. Okay. When you're driving on the highway, perhaps a little bit too fast, and then you see a speed trap, oh no, I might get a ticket. That sends a rush of adrenaline throughout your body, right? That causes your heart rate to go up, right? So panic, right? Which is really just induced by hormones, right? What else? You guys, any of you like drinking anything right now as you're watching my lecture here? Anybody drinking anything that might affect your heart rate? Coffee, that's right, Sashana. So coffee has caffeine in it, right? Which will speed up your heart rate. Anything else that might slow down your heart rate, perhaps? It wasn't always legal, but nowadays it is legal. And I hope you guys are not using that right now. But okay, meditation, Juman said, that one's legal. Yes, marijuana, right? So things like THC, right, CBD, that could cause your heart rate to change as well. Okay, so even though we don't have voluntary, conscious control over the SA note, there are things that we could do, right, to influence it. I remember watching this show, like when I was growing up. I don't know if any of you have seen it. Okay, so the it's a like a game show. Okay, so the contestant would have a heart rate monitor strapped to him or her. Okay, and then they would have to answer these questions, and every time they get the right answer, the money in the pool increases. Okay, so here's the thing though. If you get a little bit too excited, because the heart rate is being monitored in real time, right? You will start to lose money. So if your heart rate goes above, I don't know, like 75 beats per minute, then the money that you accumulate would start to go down, and you would only be allowed to answer more questions until your heart rate goes down. So I found it, you know, pretty amusing, because you know, people would answer the question and they would get like, I don't know, like $1,000 for that question. And they got so excited and their heart rate goes up, only to see the money go down. And then sometimes they would do like things to scare the contestants, or they would have like a cage of bees that would go down in front of the person, and then that would get their heart rate going up. Anyway, I just thought that was interesting show. I'm sure you can find that on YouTube. But yeah, you know, we cannot consciously control the SA note, but external factors would definitely play a role in influencing it. In any case, the SA note will send the signal spreading across your atria. It will go across like this, okay? It's going to be carried across through these things called the AV bundles. Okay, AV bundles. you know, some of the textbooks might actually have more precise name for them, but we'll just keep it vague. We're just going to call it AV bundles. It spreads the signal across the atria, and then it will cause your atria to contract. Now, the signal is not strong enough to spread through the entire heart, which is why we need another cluster of cells called the AV nodes. AV node. This is kind of like your Wi-Fi extender. Okay? You know, if you live in a house, you might have weak signal in some of the places, and you might need to boost the signal, right, in order to reach all the corners of the house. That's what the AV node is. It will take the signal from the SA node, and it will give it a boost. It will relay it, and then it will pass the signal down these fibers that are in the septum, and then it will come back up like that. Okay, so these are called the Purkinje. Purkinje fibers. Okay, and it will cause the ventricles to contract. Okay? So basically, you know, it's the SA node, pass it to the AV node, and then pass it to the Purkinje fibers. And of course, some of it will spread across through the AV bundles to cause the atria to contract as well. Okay. So I think that's a reasonable place to stop for today. Do go through the study guide on your own and see what kind of questions you can answer. We'll probably have time to take up some of them. There are some like more diagrams to color. There are some fill in the blanks that you can do on your own, for example, right? Like the first one, the three layers of the heart wall starting at the deepest layer are, right? Hopefully you remember that, right? It's the endocardium, myocardium, and epicardium, right? So do as much as you can. And then we'll take up whatever we can. Tashana asks, so there is a study guide for each lecture. Yes, right? There are a total of 12 study guides. Okay, and you should definitely do them and then print them for each of the lecture. All right. So I will post this recording online. It takes some time to upload and stuff like that, but it will be available. Actually, you know what? Hold on. I'll show you where to find it. Okay. I will post a link as well, but it's probably better if you go bookmark it yourself. The easiest way to access it right now is to go to the course homepage. And there is a button called virtual tutorial. Okay, so you just click on that. And it will take you to the page. Obviously, there's nothing right now, but I will post the link as they become available. Okay, so today you will see cardiovascular system part one. And then I will post a YouTube link for that. Okay, so bookmark this page and just come back to this regularly for the updates. All right. Okay, well, thanks a lot, everyone, for coming to class. I will see you all Wednesday at 8:30 again. All right, you have a good day. Bye for now.